play more love, more power. Okay. We're just going to do more love, more power real quick.
Welcome to worship. We give thanks to God that the Holy Spirit has gathered us into worship today to hear the good news of God's grace and mercy for us this day. Some announcements of our life together. Today during worship service, we'll be installing our council and also our ministry team leaders and standing committee members for the important ministry that they are helping realize here at Creator Lutheran Church. So we give thanks for their willingness to serve. And then after church, anybody who's willing to stick around and move chairs, Vacation Bible School begins on Monday at 9 a.m. So we need to push all the chairs and stack them in the back row of the overflow space. So if that's something that appeals to you and you're able to do, come and help, stay around and help that, and then get some coffee or whatnot. Another request we have is that New Hope Lunch for this Friday still has some need of some more donations. There is a QR code in here or in the email. There's actually a link. If you're better at linking than scanning, there's both options are available to you. So that is for this coming Friday. Other things are coming up in August to save the date, like our annual church picnic, and other such activities, so put those on your calendar so that we can have a good turnout and enjoy each other's company. I believe those are all of our announcements, so please rise as we prepare our hearts and our minds for worship. We worship in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Read responsively Psalm 136. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast mercy endures forever.
We give thanks to the Lord, God, for his steadfast mercy
endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord of Lords, for his steadfast mercy endures forever.
We give thanks to our Lord, who alone does great wonders for us, for his steadfast mercy endures forever.
Give thanks to the Lord, who by his word made heaven and earth, for his steadfast mercy endures forever.
We give thanks to God, who spread out the earth above the waters, for his steadfast mercy endures forever.
Give thanks to the Lord, who made the great light, for his steadfast mercy endures forever.
We give thanks to the Lord, for he gave us a son to rule over the day, for his steadfast mercy endures forever.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he gave us the moon and the stars to rule over the night, for his steadfast mercy endures forever.
We give thanks to the Lord our God, for he created us and all that exists, and he protects and preserves us in body and in spirit.
Let us sing our gathering hymn, Children of the Heavenly Father.
From whom no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Most merciful God,
we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways. To the glory of your holy name. Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you, and for his sake, God forgives you all of your sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Merciful Father, you make and keep your promises to us for all generations. Remove our hardness of heart and fear from us, so that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith. Keep us rooted and grounded in your love. Give us strength to comprehend and breadth and length and height and depth of your mercy for us. Help us to know the love and forgiveness of Christ that surpasses knowledge, so that we are filled with the fullness of your promises. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated for the morning scripture readings.
The first reading is from Genesis, the 9th chapter. Then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "Behold, I establish my covenant with you and your offspring after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the livestock, and every beast of the earth with you, as many as came out of the ark, it is for every beast of the earth. I establish my covenant with you that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of the flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth." And God said, "This is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all future generations. I have set my bow in the cloud, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the waters shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds
to care for us and to protect us, we ask you that you continue to be with us and to place your word in our ears and in our hearts so that we can trust you completely and are not afraid of you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen." All right, you can go back to your seats. Thank you for coming. All right. And please, the congregation, stand up for our gospel acclamation. Our Holy Gospel from the Gospel of Mark, the 6th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Immediately after feeding the crowd,
Jesus made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side, to Bethsaida, while he dismissed the crowd. And after he had taken leave of them, he went up on the mountain to pray. And when evening came, the boat was out on the sea, and he was alone on the land. And Jesus saw that they were making headway painfully, for the wind was against them. In about the fourth watch of the night, he came to them, walking on the sea. He meant to pass by them, but when they saw him walking on the sea, they thought it was a ghost, and cried out, for they all saw him and were terrified. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." And he got into the boat with them, and the wind ceased. And they were utterly astounded, for they did not understand about the loaves, but their hearts were hardened. When they had crossed over, they came to land at Gennesaret and moored on the shore. And when they got out of the boat, the people immediately recognized Jesus and ran about the whole region and began to bring the sick people on their beds to wherever they heard he was. And wherever Jesus came, in villages, cities, and countryside, they laid the sick in marketplaces and implored Jesus that they might touch even the fringe of his garment. And as many as touched it were made well. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, fear is something that we are very familiar with. we are absolutely no strangers to fear. But fear, as you heard with the children, is something that we are not born with. When we are little, we say that we are fearless. There is nothing we can't do or dare to attempt doing. One, because we'd not know better. And second, because we trust completely that we are being cared for. We are most certainly sure that nothing can harm us, and there is nothing to be afraid of. When we are very young, we do not care where our food, clothing, or anything that we need from day to day is coming from, because it just appears, almost like magic. We need food, it's in the fridge, or maybe already cooked on the table. Maybe dishes are already done. What happened? And for as much or as little as we have growing up, we do not know if it is much or little. Whatever we need just usually comes. We do not need to worry or be afraid. In fact, we do not know what worry or fear is. Everything comes through the form of our parents or grandparents or anybody like that in our lives. So we see time and again that fear instead is learned. And fear we usually see is mainly learned in one of two ways. One, by our parents' teaching, such as, do not climb that tree, or I promise you, you will fall off it and it will hurt. Do not touch the stove while it's still hot, or I promise you, you will get burned. And do not eat and walk or run at the same time, or I promise you, you will choke. So it is not in vain that we have children's books like the one we just read, Five Silly Monkeys, with the hopes our children will not get hurt. This is the fear parents and grandparents have all the time. So we teach and we hope. But the second way to learn fear is a more real, effective, and practical way. Actually being one or all of the five little monkeys at once. The actual experience of climbing up a tree and falling from it and getting hurt. Or touching the stove while it's still hot and getting burnt. Choking with food because we actually did not listen and ran or even walked. And even actually falling off the bed, or the couch if we push the limits. Then fear sets in for the most part, as you hopefully learn your lesson sooner or later, and you tend to then know better. And we come to realize that life is very good at giving you those very real, effective, and practical lessons, whether you learn from them or not. The very sure thing you do learn is that sooner or later, you will get hurt. That is a promise your parents and grandparents can't break. So finally, fear sets in. So we learn as we grow up that we need to set guardrails to hopefully protect and preserve ourselves and those around us. We learn how frail life is, and we learn not to completely trust, because with time, we experience fear and pain. We can't bring ourselves to trust any longer, and with good reason. We know we can't trust ourselves all the way, much less those around us. We are very good at calculating whether something or someone is truly trustworthy or not. We have gotten our good share of empty promises as well. And even if we want to trust, well, we get scared of the pain others can inflict in us. So we are careful and we look for what is tried and true. But still with some caution, because you never know when that thing or person will fail you, whether their promise is sure or not. In a way, we have learned a lesson or two. And even when we experience goodness, we do not trust it. And we do not trust that it is complete and real, or that it will actually last for very long. So we say, well, enjoy it while it lasts. And this is what we see with the disciples. They have experienced life, and we can only assume that in their life, they have experienced both joy and sorrow. Then in comes Jesus into their life, this strange man who calls them to follow him, and they can't help themselves but follow. In comes this wise but peculiar teacher who can do great miracles, healing the sick, feeding multitudes, and casting out demons, to mention some. But they are not quite sure about this man yet. The Son of God, the promised Christ, the Savior of the world. They have seen what Jesus is capable of, and even though they can believe their eyes because they have actually seen him, they can't fully trust and believe that the one they had been waiting for is completely for real. But why? Well, in order for Jesus to have healed the sick, there had to be illness in the first place. For Jesus to have fed multitudes, there had to be first hunger. For Jesus to have cast out demons, there had to be demons in the first place, attacking and possessing people that they could not help themselves. So they needed Jesus. So how can they truly trust this promised Messiah? Well, they can't. We can't. We see destruction all around us. We experience hardships, illness, worry, our own demons, ghosts from the past, and hunger in different ways. And even when we have a promise, we have the hardest time trusting it. We can't. We should, but that does not mean that we actually can. At least not by our own strength and effort, not by what we see or experience, and certainly not by what we feel in our own flesh. Take, for example, our reading from Genesis. God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "Behold, I will establish my covenant with you and your offspring after you, and with every living creature that is with you. I establish my covenant with you that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of the flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth. I have set my rainbow in the cloud, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth, and the water shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh." So this can only mean that there was destruction to begin with. For this covenant, or better yet, this testament from God to Noah and everyone after Noah, including you and me, to be given, only points out that there was a flood that God himself sent, which destroyed almost everything on earth except Noah, his family, and the animals in the ark. As God's people, we know what God is capable of, even destruction and death. But at the same time, God gives not only to the entire creation, but to you and me also, a big promise. A promise that is unbreakable and everlasting, with a beautiful sign. The rainbow in the sky is a reminder of a very big and specific promise from God to us, that he will not flood the earth ever again, that he will not cause destruction and death anymore, which we very well know he is very capable of. This is like when a father or mother promise their child many very severe consequences for their disobedience, which they are very capable of, but they don't do it in the end, right? We want to do it. If you don't do this, or if you do this, you will get a consequence, right? And we want to do it right there, but we stop ourselves. And we're like, I wish I could, but I won't. For the most part. Because many of us experience the paddle, maybe a belt or two, or even a flying sandal if we dare to run. No, just me? No, okay then. Well, it is the same with God, and even more so. But instead of choosing complete destruction, God chooses mercy. That is, that he is very capable of wiping off the whole earth from its existence, but he chooses not to do it. Instead, he is merciful. He promised to be with us and for us, not against us. But not in a very general and abstract way that he is immortal, immovable, invincible, inaccessible, God only wise, like pie in the sky type of God. No, he comes in the flesh for you and for me, whether you believe him or not, or whether you trust him or not, because in reality, we cannot bring ourselves to trust in him completely. And we can't because of our fear, because of our pain, because of what we experience in this world, because our hearts are hardened. We are so self-absorbed with our struggles that we are even afraid of our own shadow. Our senses do not help us believe. Contrary to popular belief, we see time and again that believing, that seeing is not believing. But thankfully, believing does not depend on you or me, but in Christ alone, who bestows upon you and me faith. Trust in him that he promises, that what he promises is actually true and sure, giving us a believing heart. And this is what happens with the disciples. They had seen, they had experienced firsthand the difficulties of life, sin, death, and the devil in their own flesh and in the people around them. And even when they had front row seats to see and experience Jesus' mercy for them, that is, Christ's own forgiveness, life, salvation, and miracles, they're still afraid. Just last week you heard how Jesus had mercy on a multitude of people because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And miraculously, Jesus fed 5,000 plus people. And yet, the disciples did not understand it. That is, they did not believe him. They could not bring themselves to trust this Jesus, this merciful Lord. And as they went alone on the boat, as Jesus commanded, even though they were making headway, it wasn't without pain. As we read, they were making headway painfully. And as Jesus intended to pass by them, minding his own business, the disciples thought Jesus was a ghost, to the point that they were terrified, they were afraid. But Jesus, just as he did with the multitude of people, sheep without a shepherd, he immediately spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Easier said than done, I know. But he, Jesus, got into the boat with them, and what happened? The wind ceased. The promise that we get from God in Genesis is that he will not flood the earth again. But that does not mean that we will be free from wildfires, earthquakes, volcanic eruptions, or anything like it. And in the same way, Jesus' promise to get in the boat with us, to be with us and for us, does not mean that we will not die, get sick, face hardships, or anything like it. Christ's promise for you is that he is with you and for you in the midst of pain, hopelessness, unfaith, loss, and tribulation. To our senses, this does not sound like very good news at all. But that does not mean that Christ's promise is not true and sure for you. As Jesus comes into the boat with the disciples, Jesus is the very same, in the same way, comes into your life. Not telling you, take heart, as if saying, come on now, buckle up, buttercup, and get a grip on yourself already, because this is going to be a bumpy ride. And Jesus certainly does not give the disciples, or you for that matter, tips and strategies to lower and manage your anxiety for what troubles you, or tells you to pull yourself by your bootstraps. No. Jesus not only gave the disciples a promise, but gave them all of himself, just as he does with you today and always. It is true that we are not promised that death will not happen to us, illness, difficulty, and the many things that we face in this life. But you are promised and given Christ's forgiveness, peace, and life. A God who is very close to you, so close that he is with you and in you, and you are in him. He is not a distant God far off from you, but a God who comes all the way to you in his very flesh, bringing you comfort where you are suffering, peace when you are having hardships, forgiveness where you see your sin, soothing where you are having pain, and life when you are seeing and experiencing death. In the midst of whatever you are going through, Jesus is here with you. Jesus is here for you, telling you, it is I. Take heart, for I am here for you and with you. I have claimed you as my child in your baptism, and I will never let you go. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
For those who have been elected to council positions and ministry team chairs, please come forward. The following church members, having been elected by the congregation to positions of leadership, are asked to come forward as we read their names. Can you advance it, Abigail, to the council member side? One more, two more. One more, there you go. Our president this year, Judy Anderson. President-elect, Andrew Mason. Secretary, Karen Exe. Secretary-elect, Cheryl Wicks. Treasurer, Judy Richardson. Treasurer-elect, Laura Brannon. Communicator, Eric Anderson. Communicator-elect, Darren Adams. Ministry team chairs, children, youth, and family, Kate Wire and Stephanie Cornejo. Church and society, Kim Adams. Creator Cares, Deborah Anderson. Education, Karen Exe. Fellowship, Kathleen Worley, Lisa Wire. Property, Sean Reed. Stewardship, Dave Exe. Invitation and welcome, Dave Anderson. Worship and music, Pastor Horacio Castillo. Standing committees as well. Personnel, Dave, Judy, and Terry Hayford. Finance, Jim Larson, Sherry Dunn, and Joe Jessup. Audit, Dave, Kevin Davis, and Laura Brannon. Well, not everybody's able to be here today, but please turn towards me. In holy baptism, our Lord Jesus Christ freed you from sin, death, and the power of the devil, and made you members of his church. Through word and sacrament, you have been nurtured in faith. I ask you together with all those gathered here to confess the faith of the church, the faith in which we were baptized. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. St. Paul writes, "Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit, and there are varieties of service, but the same Lord, and there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who is working them all in everyone. To each is given a manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. You have been elected to positions of leadership and trust in this congregation. You are to see that the words and deeds of this household of faith reflect Jesus in those in whose name we gather. You are to work together with other members to see that the worship and work of Christ are done in this congregation, and that God's will is done in this community and in the whole world. You are to be diligent in your specific areas of serving, that the one Lord who calls you is glorified. You are to be examples of Christian living to help maintain the life and harmony of this congregation. On behalf of your brothers and sisters in Christ, I ask you, are you ready to accept and faithfully carry out the responsibilities of the offices to which you have been elected? If so, say yes by the help of God. In the congregation, people of God, I ask you, will you support these, your elected brothers and sisters? Why don't you turn around and look at them? Look at each other in the eyes here. And will you share in the mutual ministry of service that Christ has given to all who are baptized? If so, say yes by the help of God.
Yes, by the help of God.
I now declare you installed as council members and ministry team leaders of this congregation. God bless you with his Holy Spirit, who has called you through the gospel, enlightened you with his gifts, and sanctified and kept you in his one true faith. Amen. You may return to your seats. Let's give a round of applause. Thank you. Congregation, please rise for our prayers.
People according to their needs. Heavenly Father, you have made us your own dear children through holy baptism. Strengthen us with the gifts of your Holy Spirit so that your Son continues to dwell in our hearts through faith, and that we would be rooted and grounded in your love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, as you preserved Noah and his family and brought forth new life from the ark under the promise of your covenant, continue to bless our families also. Make marriages strong and fruitful according to your will. Let your word dwell in every home, uniting its members in forgiveness and causing your Son to live in every heart through faith. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful Lord, we ask you to spare us and our future generations from wickedness. Give blessings to our nation and its leaders to serve according to your good pleasure. Protect the elected leaders, those running for office, the members of our armed forces, police, and other public servants. Give us and the world the hope, forgiveness, and love to live in harmony and peace. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, we, your people, cry out for your healing upon our brothers and sisters in Christ who are suffering in body and spirit, and those who have many other needs. As you sent your Son to heal and to make whole, give them and us to trust you alone, for you never leave, forsake, or forsake them. Bring them the healing they need, Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us share Christ's peace with one another. Peace of Christ. Peace be with you. Christ, peace be with you.
Well, he makes it easy because I got to go left-handed.
So this piece is with you.
What side do you want? Don't stay on that side.
Why have you disappeared?
Don't be afraid. I was in a situation.
That's true.
Get to the sharing of the piece. I know for the introverts among you, it's probably the worst, like, 2 minutes of service. So I see you right now, but it's also, I love the fact that this church likes to get to know each other and the ones around you. So thank you for being who you are, Creator. Let us now receive our morning offering.
Thank you.
Lord, we give you
thanks and praise that you bless us with all we need from day to day. In your abundance, continue to bless us, providing for our physical and spiritual needs. Help us be good neighbors to those around us, and give us the faith to trust you alone, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us pray together the prayer our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
You may be seated. I'd like the communion assistants to please come forward. We'll be communing at two stations in front today. As you come forward, you'll be given bread. If you need gluten-free communion, let us know. And you'll take either wine or grape juice. The lighter is the grape juice. And then you'll return to your seats. If you need to have us come to you, please let the ushers know, and we'd be happy to do that. These are God's gifts for you, God's people. Come.
Thank you.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Let us pray. We give you
thanks, Almighty God, that you have forgiven our sins through the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. We pray that in your mercy you give us peace, assuring us your grace is enough. And we ask you to strengthen us in your life-giving faith, to live our lives in trust toward you and in love toward our neighbor, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
So I know I'm telling you how wonderful you are today, so I have one other thing to tell you about how wonderful you are today, and that is these people over here today. Not every church that can have guitar and trumpet lead us in worship. But also it's not every church that when the pianist for the day, Mark Thompson, his mother's in hospice. And so he's not able to be here today, Susan Thompson. And so we stepped up as Creator, and we made a beautiful music together, and we praised our Lord. How amazing are we, Creator? God is good. So receive God's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Christ is with you.